are so delighted to have Stefanie Overstreet here with us today. She's the wife of Chris Overstreet, yes, and she's a nurse. I know you're going to tell yourself, she can probably tell you more about herself, but I just met her today, but I've been emailing her back and forth, and I can tell she is a delight. And I just look so forward to hearing what she has to share with us today. So, Stephanie, come on.
Well, it's so good to be with you all. Thank you so much for having me. Just so I get an idea, would you raise your hand if you've heard my husband Chris speak or been to? Okay. Most of us are familiar with him and Compassion to Action. He does all the speaking, so this isn't something I ever envisioned myself doing. But the Lord started speaking to me about it 9 years ago. And so when I would travel with Chris, I would just start to share a word of encouragement just out of obedience, because I was terrified to talk into a microphone. And for a lot of years, I felt like people would give me words about, you're not in Chris's shadow, you have a voice, and you have something to say, and I always just kind of thought, like, I don't know that I really have any, I just didn't really have a whole lot to say for a long time. And then I went through the experience I'm going to share with you today, because now I have something to say. So it's so interesting. Sandy and I didn't talk about what we were going to share at all, but it dovetails perfectly, as we know. We know God works that way. So a little bit about me. Chris and I decided to move to Vancouver a year ago. My family moved there when I was 13, so I spent part of my growing up high school in Vancouver, nursing school up in Tacoma, and then I moved to Reading. And that's where I met Chris and doing the outreach ministry in Reading. And so we were married and I lived there for a total of 11 years before coming back here. So this is like coming home, but it's changed a lot in a lot of good ways. And it's something we never really envisioned, actually. In fact, my dad would talk to Chris and say, we've got a really nice international airport right here, and this would be a good home base. And Chris was like, we love you, but we're never going to live here.
I know.
Yeah. And so the process that the Lord took me through over the last few years is actually what really brought us around to the idea of living here. I think you get to hear the back story maybe on how we ended up here, the ministry opportunities. The things I've seen Chris be able to do and the receptivity here, it blows us away, because we just know that God is doing something now. He's already been working. But I think what we're seeing now is the result of decades of prayer and sowing into. So we feel like we just had the opportunity to say yes to a dream in God's heart for long before we came along. And so it's an honor, and I always just feel so humbled as I get to watch what God's doing and how Chris's heart really is to bring encouragement and strength to the churches that are here and to really equip the everyday believer. It's just been really amazing to be a part of that and see that. So I want to talk about going from surrender to victory in the process. And I think it really is something that we do over and over again. It's not a one-time thing. Let's see. So like I shared earlier, I met Chris when I moved to Reading after university as a nurse. I graduated from nursing school and I got a dream job in Reading. I wanted to attend the church. church Bethel there for a while, and then eventually do the school ministry, and my heart was to do mission work as a nurse. And so I actually didn't want anything to do with evangelism. I was terrified of it. And then right before I moved, I received a prophetic word, and it said something along the lines of, I see you and you're like a wheel going, and this other wheel is going to come alongside you, and the two of you are going to be a part of reaching millions of people for the Lord. And I just remember, like, it can't be me, because they called me out of the crowd, you know? And I was like, that can't be me. But I remember coming away from that, and I felt like the Lord kind of spoke to my heart, like, that word might not really come to pass if you don't do something to partner with it. Like, I felt like this opportunity ahead of me, like, that I got to step into it. And I think as I was driving here, I was thinking about that and how I got involved in outreach when I moved to Reading to make friends and build community, and that's how I met Chris. And then I think about this other part of my story that I'm about to share and how that was really a step of obedience. And it's so interesting how, like, our greatest, some of our greatest things that propel us into our destiny or who we're really called to be, sometimes it starts out with just a step of obedience, or I don't really feel like it, or I'm not really sure about this God, the trust in God piece. So Chris and I, after we got married, I went to the school of ministry and worked part-time as a nurse, and then I started getting to travel with him. And I think I've grown up in the church and had a relationship with the Lord my whole life, and I had a wonderful family. My parents have been in ministry my whole life. So I would say that for me, one of my favorite verses, Hebrews 10:23 says, let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. And so I feel like that verse, it defined my story, because I saw God's faithfulness to me over and over again, and I saw so many dreams fulfilled. My first job out of nursing school, they told me they wouldn't take a new graduate, and they changed their mind in the interview. I met my husband right when I moved to Reading, and it was just like getting to travel with him and work part-time in a job that I loved. There were so many dreams fulfilled. And so eventually, after we'd been married a couple of years, we felt like it was time to start a family. And I knew that we were supposed to have children, but I definitely found myself feeling like, well, I had some fears about it, because it's a huge transition. And at the time, I was 29 when Grail was born. So I did have a number of years of young adulthood and, you know, career and doing all those things. And so it was just, I wrestled with it for a while. I wrestled with working through some of the fears and trusting, am I really going to trust God about this big transition? And a lot of people said, like, well, your kids will just come with you when you travel, and it'll be fine. And I think in my heart, I was kind of like, yeah, but, like, there's just a lot. There's no guarantees of how things are going to play out. So I kind of felt like, maybe, but I could be, like, my life could, it will completely change, and I don't necessarily know how that's going to look. So I remember we had watched Heidi Baker's biographical film about her life, and Chris and I both have a love for Africa. That was one of the things that we had in common when we first met. And so after we watched the film about her story, I remember doing the dishes and praying, and I told the Lord, like, we have this nice home and these great jobs, and we love what we're doing here, but if you want us to go to Africa, like, you know that we would just lay everything down and go. And I felt like the Lord said, well, yeah, I know that about you. I know your heart. Like, I don't doubt that. But would you like to know what I am wondering about? And I was like, well, sure. And I felt like he said, I'm wondering if you would be willing to become mom. And it was the first time that I think I needed that from him. I think I needed that, like, invitation that's to my heart. And so it meant so much to me that in his eyes, answering the call to become a mom was just as valuable as answering the call to the mission field.
Yes.
Like, that was actually, motherhood was actually the mission field
yes.
he was calling me to
yes.
at that time. And so I think after that, it was really like, well, I could continue traveling and working and doing all these great things for the kingdom, but if it's not what you're asking me to do right now, then is it really for you, or is it about me? You know, and so that was, I'd say one of the biggest, one of the biggest surrender moments for me, of really being willing to surrender my, what my life looked like at the time for this kind of unknown journey. And I had to decide if I was going to trust him with the future. And so one of my favorite verses in Proverbs 3, I think most of us would probably have it memorized, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all of your ways acknowledge him and he will direct your path. And so I think that was kind of what I went forward with. And it's interesting because sometimes it's when we obey, we make the right choice, then we think that it's all going to work out really well, that we're going to be immediately rewarded for being obedient. And I think I did all the right things. I'm a nurse and I worked with children and women and families. I took care of the moms after they had a baby in the hospital. I would take care of them and send them home with the little discharge instructions, and I had no idea. Now I'm like, oh, Jesus, I didn't tell them, like, you know, because there's stuff on that paper that's like, you know, just scratching the surface there. But I thought the transition to becoming a mom would be, I knew it would be a big change. I wasn't naive to that, but I thought it would go relatively smoothly because I had kind of, we're talking about planning. I'd done a lot of planning, a lot of preparation, I'd done all the right things, and so far in my life, that had kind of panned out. It had worked out well for me. And so this was the first time that I really was going to learn that part of this verse where it says, let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. Amen. And I was thinking this week, it says without wavering for a reason. Like, because we might be tempted to waver. And so for me, I didn't really know it, but I think I struggled with depression while I was pregnant. I never really, I mean, everybody has bad days, but I had never really dealt with anything like that, so I didn't really recognize it. I just knew I didn't feel like myself, but I also knew this was a big change for me and something that I didn't really feel ready for. Like, I probably could have gone on another 10 years doing what I was doing, with traveling and working. So after I had our daughter, it was a great birth, which I'm really thankful for. But then we just had, I mean, I think the anxiety started as soon as she came out. And there were a lot of things that went wrong from the very beginning. And it was just something that completely blindsided me. I didn't really realize at the time that I had a major, like an open door to fear in my life. I'd gotten really good at managing it and overcoming it, so I actually didn't really realize that it was, a friend actually described it to me like, if you've got the door open to your kitchen, the flies are coming in, you can get really good at swatting the flies.
Oh, that's good.
But you gotta take the trash out and close the door to keep them from coming back in.
That's good.
That was when I got free, was in that inner healing session. Because it was such a powerful picture to me, because I kind of thought, like, well, I'm really good at overcoming fear. I mean, I wouldn't be here if I didn't overcome fear just to get pregnant, you know? But I think what we fear, we empower.
Yes.
And so I think that fear really just kind of created a landing place for things to happen that were definitely not God's heart for me. And so I ended up going through postpartum depression and anxiety that was pretty severe. I felt like I completely lost myself. I mean, I didn't lose touch with reality and kind of like the psychosis piece that we hear on the news, but I definitely was not, I wasn't who I was emotionally at all. My thinking wasn't normal. There was so much irrational anxiety and fear, and I had mood swings for the first time. This is the first time I ever remember being that angry at my husband, because we hardly ever fought before that. I mean, it was just like, who is this person? Like, there was part of me on the inside that was like, who are you? You know? And I have a little life to take care of now. And there's just so much that can go wrong that, I mean, I understand now why we used to have babies in villages where you'd have your mom and your sister and your aunt nearby and your friend's mom. And I mean, there's just so many things that are really challenging. And in today's culture, moms are really isolated, and we are very much independent and used to doing things on our own. And we just, so when things aren't going well, it's almost hard to know who to turn to. And a lot of my friends at the time had little children of their own. My best friend back then, she's my best friend now, but back then she had 4 kids under 4 and a set of twins in that. So it was like, she couldn't help me. And so I also had, our daughter had some, she was more of a high needs child, and we went through colic. I mean, she and I both were not doing well. It was just a hot mess. And Chris couldn't go back to work for a month. He had to stay home from work because I couldn't handle taking care of her on my own. And I think it was just such a departure from who I was, kind of this well put together, like have it all together kind of girl. And so I felt like just an extreme identity crisis of like I don't even know like how to walk through something like this, you know. I realized during that season that I hadn't had a hard day in my life before, you know, because it was like this was unlike anything else. And I remember Brielle was 9 months old and Chris was in Finland on a ministry trip, and I was trying to put her to bed and she was screaming and crying, and I had to leave the room. And I remember going, she was in her room and she was safe, but I remember I had to go to my room, and I was in the closet, and I couldn't call Chris because he was in Finland and it was the middle of the night there. And I just was being so mad at her. Like, it's been 9 months of absolute chaos. Like, I could barely leave my house. I was a shadow of who I used to be, and my daughter was struggling with development. So it was like struggles on all fronts. Nothing was going well. And I remember being really angry at God. It was the first time that I really felt like, you know, I could just walk away from you. I'm so mad at you for letting me suffer like this, for not fixing it. I felt like I knew he was there. I didn't feel like he left me, but I felt like he was just a bystander, like just watching, just like standing by and letting chaos happen to me. And that was painful because I had never been through something like that before. And in that moment, I was reminded of something that I've heard someone else say, which is we can allow those things that we don't understand to either push us away from God, or we can allow them to propel us toward Him. So we can choose to move toward Him even in the not understanding. And so I'm so thankful that somebody else had taught that, because I really did hear it come back to my mind in that moment. And I felt like it was a turning point for me, because it was like, okay, I'm going to move towards you even though I don't understand. I don't understand what you're doing. I don't understand where you are. And in that moment, He gave me this picture of, it was like what was going on with my daughter and I saw that with him and I. Like, she's in her crib screaming and crying, Mom, why aren't you fixing this for me? Mom, why aren't you doing this? I don't understand. And I was there, but I wasn't intervening because there was a skill that she needed to learn. It was a process that we were walking through. And but it wasn't that I wasn't there, and it wasn't that it didn't hurt me to see her cry. And I just remember realizing, like, oh, he is here, and this actually hurts him to see me like this. He's not just an innocent bystander, or just a bystander letting this go on. Like, he's very present and very invested. And so that for me was a huge turning point, and really that great surrendering of not my will but yours. You know, I don't understand it, but I'm going to choose you anyway. And surrendering my right to understand, my right to have things turn out the way I wanted them to, my right to the life I had before. I mean, I was not traveling at all. I didn't go to church for 9 months, which is when I just couldn't get it together. I could not take my baby to church. There were so many issues we had. It was just like going to the grocery store was about all we could do. And that was the first 9 months in my life. I think I was attending church in the womb. So to not be in church for 9 months was, I had never experienced that before either. So I had to surrender my right to control. That was probably the biggest one. And learning how to trust him, like Sandy was talking about, in that really dark place. And I started learning about putting my trust in his nature, like that verse in Hebrews talks about, he who promised is faithful. And I realized that if I put my hope in my circumstances, like how things are going to turn out, if I put my hope in motherhood coming along smoothly, like you see on social media or on TV or even friends, from the outside looking in, sometimes it feels like even your friends are really having an easy time. And I don't know. So I just remember learning that if my hope is in circumstances, then I'm going to be disappointed. Because these were real circumstances that were very disappointing. And so instead, my hope had to be in who he is, you know, his nature, his promises. Even in that place of not understanding. And I think that's really when I started, even though I grew up knowing him my whole life and I've had this relationship with him for a very long time, I feel like that's when I really started to learn about faith, because it's like faith comes alive in that place where the circumstance doesn't match up with what we believe. Yeah. And I mean, how painful is it to live in Reading and attend and be on staff at Bethel, in a place where we see miracles all the time, and we talk about walking victoriously. I didn't know what that meant. You know, like, I thought I knew. And then I went through that season, it's like, that's pretty painful to walk through that in a place where, like, your life is the exact opposite of everything that we talk about every week, everything we stand for, and my life's the exact opposite. And I remember trying to talk about it. I mean, because people would ask me how I was doing, and I couldn't hide the fact that I was a hot mess. And people just didn't know what to say, which was also really painful. And so in retrospect, I can see now that you can't really have the faith that relies on his promises and his nature without really first surrendering and trusting. Like, I kind of learned how there's like this process that we go through, like surrendering our will and our rights to things, and then, okay, God, I'm going to trust you. I'm going to trust that you're going to work all this out for my good, and even if I don't understand. And then the faith piece comes so much easier, because it's like the faith is not our measure of faith, but it's reliant on what he's doing. And I learned that it's not about feeling. I learned that faith is really a decision that requires action. Just like James talks about how faith without works or action is dead. So for me, things really started to change when I took action, even though I didn't feel like it. So after I had that encounter with God in my closet, I started going to church regularly, even though we were, you know, I was not showered, and I was an anxious mess, and I don't know, so super awkward when I would try to talk to people. I started attending a Bible study in a friend's home, even though I was struggling with horrific insomnia and not sleeping from 2 to 6 a.m. every night, but I just knew that I needed to start being in community, and also just at that time, my mind wasn't in a good place, so I had to just get the word of God from outside. Like, I really wasn't diving into scriptures at the time. I was trying, but I started just pulling from wherever I could, going to church, Bible study, listening to podcasts. I would play worship music all the time because I couldn't trust what was going on in my mind, so I had to find outside sources that could help me kind of direct my mind and my emotions in the right way. And I found two scriptures that really meant a lot to me. One was a friend kind of paraphrased Philippians 4:13, and he said, "If you will strengthen me, I can do this." Mm-hmm. And that became my phrase that I would say to the Lord all day long when I would feel like giving up. "If you will strengthen me, I can do this." And then I found a little calligraphy that said, "The Lord stood by me and strengthened me." That's in 2 Timothy 4:17. And I framed this little calligraphy on my, put it on my kitchen, and I would get a small bouquet of flowers and just have it in my kitchen all the time. Every time I'd be in the kitchen, I would look at that, and it was like, just, that was my way of like redirecting my thoughts. Like, this is where we're gonna go. This is what's true. And eventually the fog did lift, actually when I stopped nursing when she was 14 months old. So really, it wasn't until it went away within a month that I was like, oh, this really is hormonal. I did go through a program in our county for new moms struggling with depression and anxiety. And so I did get some counseling during that time, and I was really trying to work through it. But I think the whole time there was this doubt in my mind of like, maybe it's just me. Maybe I just didn't have as good of a relationship with God as I thought I did. I mean, I questioned everything. And then when it went away after I stopped nursing, I just thought, like, it was like the clouds were over the sun, and all of a sudden the clouds went away. You know, and I was like, oh, I'm me again. Like, oh, it's not that I, you know, lost my salvation. That's how I felt. It felt like I lost my mind, everything. But it was just like, oh, there was a whole, like, physical, hormonal thing going on. And so there was a couple years after that of really walking out freedom, getting free from that root stronghold of fear. When I started seeing it manifest in my daughter, then I was like, oh, we really got to take this sucker out because this cannot be passed down to her. And, you know, it's interesting because I know, like, I'm sure that that could have been dealt with earlier, but I almost think I needed to go through that whole process for the Lord to be able to, for me to see it for what it was.
Yeah.
You know, because I was so good at managing it that I think it took, not that it was his plan for me to be sick and all of that, but I think he didn't heal me instantaneously because there was a process I needed to walk through to really be able to get free, like, for good, you know? And so I realized that it was his mercy to deliver me through it instead of delivering me from it. You know, like, it was, and it took me years to figure that one out. Like, probably 3 years. So I'm telling you the story that happened over, like, 4 years of time. Which is funny because we can hear someone's story when they're sharing and we think that maybe it took them a few months. Or, like, we just sometimes, it's when we don't know all the details, we don't realize that the fruit or the testimony can sometimes take years in the making and layers upon layers of healing and freedom. And sometimes we want to so badly escape the pain and the process. But I really learned about surrendering to the process, trusting in and having faith in his His nature and His promises, and that really like became the path to victory for me. And it really showed, I actually learned kind of at the end of that journey, so okay, I'm learning about faith, and now I'm learning what does it look like to walk victoriously. And I think prior to that, I thought that walking in victory meant like having all of God's promises and having everything like prospering and having everything go really well. And I think through that, I actually learned as I was coming out of it that it's really like more of an attitude. It's walking out a belief that we get to walk in victory because of what He did on the cross. It has nothing to do with us or what we can do. I mean, that was probably the greatest thing of learning in that process and surrender was really like, God, I'm relying on You for my next breath because how do I take care of this little girl when I've had no sleep, you know? And realizing like, okay, the victory has nothing to do with anything I did. This is just receiving a gift from Him and because of what He's done. And that no matter what circumstances come, we get to walk out that victory because we know that He's faithful no matter what. And like Sandy's saying, it's like He's already secured the victory for us. So even in that in between where we don't know, we actually can walk through that in victory, which now I understand that. It took going through it without it to figure it out on the other side. And I love how God just sees things so differently than we do. I took some time after I was better emotionally. I think it may have even been, was it a few months later or a year later? I can't even remember. But I went on a healing retreat because I needed to process some of the grief and the trauma that we've been through and really be healed. And so I was in a small group and someone was leading us through an encounter with God, and so we were picturing the garden of our heart and being there with Jesus. And so we went into the garden of my heart, and I saw a garden bed, like a raised garden bed that was my motherhood garden bed. And I saw it was empty, but there were like these little green shoots, you know, and all I saw was the barrenness. And just this feeling of like, I have just totally failed at this. There's been nothing but pain and loss. You know, this is nothing like I hoped it was going to be. And I felt like Jesus looked at what was there and He said, there's a lot of work to be done here. But it wasn't like, look at this. There's so much work to be done. It was more like, look, there's so much work to be done here. Like, He saw all the potential. And so that ministered to me so much that He sees it differently than we do. Like, we can see our barrenness or our lack or the ways that we failed, and yet He sees it as this opportunity for growth. You know, He sees a garden where we see barrenness and desert. And so I wanted to close with two passages that I feel like describe what it looks like to walk in victory. And I'm going to read these ones from the Passion Translation. The first one is Hebrews 4, and it's talking about the Israelites and their journey to the Promised Land. And it says, "Now God has offered to us the same promise of entering into His realm of resting in confident faith. So we must be extremely careful to ensure that we all embrace the fullness of that promise and not fail to experience it. For we've heard the good news of deliverance just as they did, yet they didn't join their faith with the word. Instead, what they heard didn't affect them deeply, for they doubted. For those of us who believe, faith activates the promise, and we experience the realm of confident rest." And when I read that the other day, I just thought, wow, what an opportunity. Like, we could miss out on this realm of confident rest and faith in Him and His promises if we allow the doubting to come in. But verse 6 says, let's see. Those who first heard the good news of deliverance failed to enter into that realm of faith's rest because of their unbelieving hearts. Yet the fact remains that we still have the opportunity to enter into the faith rest life and experience the fulfillment of the promise. And I just thought, how good is that, that we still have the opportunity. And the last passage that I wanted to share is in Hebrews 6, where it's talking about God's promise to Abraham. And I discovered this passage this last spring as I was contending for some healing in my body. It turned out that a lot of what I went through postpartum had to do with some underlying things in my physical body. And so I ended up doing much better, you know, like, a lot of restoration in my life as a mom, enjoying my daughter, and yet still like needing some physical healing. And so I found this passage in Hebrews 6 where he's talking about God's promise to Abraham. And it says in verse 18, "So it's impossible for God to lie, for we know that his promise and his vow will never change." And this is also in Passion Translation. "Now we have run into his heart to hide ourselves in his faithfulness. This is where we find his strength and comfort, for he empowers us to seize what has already been established ahead of time, an unshakable hope. And we have this certain hope like a strong, unbreakable anchor, holding our souls to God himself, our anchor of hope fastened to the mercy seat, which sits in the heavenly realm beyond the sacred threshold, and where Jesus, our forerunner, has gone before us." And I just love that verse so much. Like, oh, we get to, like, not only do we have his promises, but we get to run into his heart to hide ourselves in his faithfulness. And there we find his comfort and strength, and he empowers us. And I think that that was such a beautiful picture of what it looks like to walk victoriously. It's not just that if we get all of our prayers answered and everything goes smoothly and we get to be in control like I used to be. It's that attitude of no matter what comes, that truth remains. And I think that this really is an ongoing process. And even as I was working on this message this week, because I lived it over the last few years, but as I was kind of putting it together, I found myself over and over with things coming up and going, oh, okay, I gotta surrender. Like, if it starts to get swirly and things are getting all over the place, then I know, like, oh, I need to go back to that place of surrender first. Like, okay, I'm gonna surrender this to you, Lord, and now I'm gonna trust you, even though I don't understand. Okay, and what is your word said? What is your nature? What does your word say about this? You know, and that's going to empower me to walk it out. As far as just to finish the story with my journey with motherhood, along the way, as I started to get healed and set free from all of that, I realized, especially during the postpartum period, how much I was being lied to by the enemy. And so as I got free, I decided that that's what I wanted to focus on in my nursing career, was to help other moms. I decided to be the voice that I couldn't find. I remember spending hours on the internet looking for, how do you deal with postpartum depression and anxiety as a Christian woman? Because I could not find anything. And I was so like, just looking for direction. And so I decided since then, like, okay, I think this is what I already kind of enjoy working with moms and families, but I felt like, well, now I have a mandate. Now I have some authority, and so I can bring some truth and some freedom to other moms. And so really, like, through that process of going through postpartum, I felt like I watched my life just burn down before my eyes. You know, I couldn't travel with Chris anymore. Our daughter's not wanting to travel, so that's just not going to be, it's just not what it once was. And I had to let go of that. And I had to let go of even my prior nursing career. I tried to go back to work multiple times, and God not only, like, shut the door, but he took the women that I was going to work for on two separate occasions and moved them out of state. So it was like he was going to make sure that I was not escaping that And right before we left Reading, I started working for an OB who has a private practice, and she has nurses teach group prenatal classes to her clients. And I discovered a love for teaching. And so I decided to kind of take this journey that I've been on, and right now I'm in the process of figuring out how I'm going to package it and then take my nursing practice online so that I can help moms from there. Like, if they're nursing at 3 a.m., I want there to be some kind of a resource they can listen to right there from their home. This week I've had several friends reach out to me asking some really hard questions about similar things that they're walking through. Not the same as me, but I just remember crying over God's faithfulness and realizing, like, okay, it's been 4.5 years since I had my daughter, and I now have, like, when they ask for wisdom and advice, I'm actually able to share his heart with them out of compassion, having been there myself. And I'm just in awe of how he can take something so devastating, so awful, I wouldn't wish it on my worst enemy. And he rewrites the story. Because when I look back, I'm like, oh, there wasn't a day that you weren't by my side. You were there. You never left me. And look at what you brought out.